Okay, so in this video we're going to talk about similar triangles. Now, in mathematics, when we use the word similar, we basically mean they have equal angles, okay? So two triangles are said to be similar if they have equal angles. So you can see there that yellow angle is equal to that angle there is equal to that angle, and the green angle there is equal to the green angle. If you remind yourselves of our uses of the proofs for congruency, we have SSS, ASA, SAS and RHS. What's interesting to note is AAA is not something that you can prove congruency, because congruency of course means if two things are congruent they're exactly the same. And of course if you just prove that you have three of the angles that are equal to each other, the shapes may not be exactly the same. And the reason is because, of course, you may have something like this. These triangles are obviously not exactly the same. One is an enlargement of the other, although they do have equal angles. So when you have the three angles in a triangle equal to another three angles in another triangle, they are similar. They are not exactly the same. The only thing that you can say about them is they have equal angles. But what you know once they have equal angles is that the sides must be in proportion. What I mean by that is whatever you have multiplied to this base here to get this larger base here, then that same multiplier must have been multiplied to this left-hand side to get the corresponding larger left-hand side in the enlarged triangle. And the very same multiplier, again, would hold true for the right-hand side to get the corresponding right-hand side of the triangle. So once you know that you have similar triangles, you know immediately that whatever you've multiplied to any of the sides in a smaller triangle to get the larger sides in the bigger triangle, it's the same for each of the sides. So the scale factor, if you want to refer back to word we'd use in enlargements, once you know that the angles are equal, the sides are in proportion, the scale factor has to be equal for all of the sides. So the theorem basically states if two triangles ABC and DEF are similar, in other words, they have equal angles, then their sides are proportional. And that's just the way it's listed out there in formal terms. Let's jump straight into an example here so we can see exactly what that means for us in terms of lengths and numbers, etc. Okay, so let's take this example. In this question, we're trying to find the lengths of the sides X and Y. If you feel you might have an idea how to do this, then by all means pause the video and see how you get on. Otherwise, I'm going to talk through this one very thoroughly. So, let's take a look. We know straight away, as we said, the triangles are similar. We can see that quite clearly. The angles are equal, so the sides have to be in proportion. So the first thing you want to look for is the corresponding sides that are going to give you the most bit of information. And we can see from that the two sides that we do have information on are the left-hand sides, those corresponding sides here. Six in the smaller triangle corresponds with the nine in the bigger triangle. So the left-hand side in the smaller triangle corresponds with the left-hand side in the larger triangle. And because of the theorem, we know that since they are similar triangles, the sides are in proportion. What that means is whatever I am multiplying to that 6, now I'm going to call it K, okay, because we sometimes associate K with scale factor. So I'm going to use K. 6 times something, in other words, has to equal 9, okay? You have done something to the 6. You've multiplied it by something to enlarge it to get 9. And whatever I figure out that something to be, it's going to be the same multiplier to that base to get the larger base and to the right-hand side to get the larger right-hand side. And that means then I know exactly how to go about finding my x value and my y value. So let's solve this equation we have here. So I know that 6 times something is 9, so divide both sides by 6 and I get that k is equal to 9 over 6, which of course could be simplified to 3 over 2 or 1.5. So the multiplier is 1.5. In other words, the left-hand side multiplied by 1.5 gives you the right-hand side larger side in the triangle. That's true then for the base. The base times 1.5 gives you this larger base here as well. So watch the order. Obviously we're going from the smaller to the bigger with the way that we've set this up. So Taking that base 9, I know 9 also must be multiplied by 3 over 2 then in order to get the larger base, which of course we have as x. It has to be the same multiplier. And the answer is then 13.5. Okay, so that's the length of x. Now let's go and figure out the y. So again, we're always going smaller to larger with the way we set up our very original equation. So that means that this 12, again, the multiplier must be the same. And we know now the multiplier is 3 over 2, must therefore equal the larger right-hand side length, which is y. So 12 times 3 over 2 must equal y. And that is 18. So there are my two results. X is 13.5 and Y is 18. Okay, so we're going to look at this question next. So pause the video and see how you got on this. We're looking for the values of X and Y again, the lengths of those sides. Okay, so I've redrawn the sketch out for myself here. And what's interesting to note in this question is obviously these two angles are equal, they're marked the same, and these two angles are equal, they're marked the same. But they haven't marked the third angle equal. But of course, since the three angles of a triangle add to 180, if you know two of the angles are the same, then it follows on, obviously, that the third angle has to also be the same. Okay, so whether they mark that third angle or not, if you know two of the angles in the triangle are the same, then obviously, because the three angles, no matter what size a triangle, have to always add to make 180, your third top angle, or your bottom angle in this case, has to be the same here. Okay, so the first thing we got to do is look for the corresponding sides that's going to give us the most information. The information is going to tell us about the scale factor, what we're doing to one side in order to get the enlarged side. So in this case, it's going to be the 8 and the 12. They're the two bits of information on corresponding sides that I have. So they're the ones I'm going to use. So in other words, 8 times something equals 12. So in order to find out that something, get the k on its own, dividing by both sides by 8, and we're getting 3 over 2 again, or 1.5. So that's always how you're going to get your first bit of information. You're looking for corresponding sides that both have pieces of information on it. So you know the lengths of both those sides, in other words. So given that we know the scale factor from the smaller, because this is the direction we did it in, 8 times something gives you the 12, then from the smaller to the larger, everything's going to be multiplied by 1.5. That's your key bit of information. So using that now, let's have a look at this left-hand side here. So that means then the 6 times 1.5 must equal the corresponding left-hand side in the larger triangle. So therefore, 6 times 1.5 gives you x. And so 6 times 1.5 is 9, so therefore 9 is equal to x. Okay, now looking at the top. So the smaller top must again be multiplied by 1.5 to get the larger top, which in this case is y. So we have 7 times the same scale factor, 1.5, must equal the y. Therefore y is equal to 10.5. Okay, next question. So pause the video here and see how you get on. We want to figure out the values for x and y. Now, straight away, the orientation of these makes it a little bit confusing, especially to see what side is corresponding to what. So a very good tip in a situation like this would be to draw another sketch for yourself and orientate those triangles the same way around, so you've got a better idea of how to link these up and see what's corresponding to what. So that's exactly what I'm going to do now. And so here's what we have. Now be very careful when you're doing that and just double check and triple check that you have lined them up correctly. And by all means, turn the book or the exam paper right around to make sure that you are drawing them out in the right way around, so that you have the correct bases at the bottom, if you like, the corresponding bases and corresponding left-hand sides and right-hand sides. Once you're confident that you have that right, then again, as before, you look at which sides have two pieces of information on them that are going to give you information about the scale factor. And I can see it's going to be my right-hand side here. That right-hand side on the smaller triangle corresponds with that right-hand side on the larger triangle. So It is 9 times something gives 15. So 9 times something gives me 15. And then divide both sides by 9. And that will tell me what that something is. In other words, what that scale factor is. And we're getting 5 over 3. Or 1 and 2 thirds. Okay, so that means everything on the left-hand side, all of these sides multiplied by 5 over 3 gives the corresponding larger sides in the enlarged triangle. So I'm going to analyze the base next. So the base in the smaller is 6. 6 times this scale factor we know must give you the y. So 6 times 5 over 3 must give you the larger base y. And that answer is 10. Okay, now looking at the last side, to analyze is of course the left-hand side, and this left-hand side corresponds with this larger left-hand side. So this says it's y as well, which means that is obviously, now we know of course, 10. Y is 10. So 10 times the scale factor must give me the larger side, x. So 10 times 5 over 3 must equal the x. Therefore, x is equal to 16 and 2 thirds. And that's your value for x, and that's your value now for y. Okay, try this question. So here we're looking for the values of a and b. So pause the video here and see how you get on with this. Okay, so like before, the first thing I've done for myself is to redraw this and orientate the triangles so I can see more clearly what side is corresponding to what side. So once I have it here, I'm looking for my two corresponding sides that both have numbers on them, so that can give me information about the scale factor, and I can see that that's here on my base. So these are the two corresponding bases. 10, in other words, times something gives me the 12, divide both sides by 10, and I get that that something, or that scale factor k, is 1.2. Okay, so that's what I'm going to use. All of these smaller sides, in other words, times by 1.2, give the corresponding larger sides in the large triangle. So, now I'm going to look at the right-hand side here. So this right-hand side corresponds to this right-hand side here. So this smaller one multiplied by the scale factor must give me the larger one, b. So in other words, 8 times 1.2 must give me b. And that implies then that b is equal to 9.6. Now, given that we're given units in this question, make sure you put your units in. So 9.6 centimeters is b. Now, slightly different to what we've come across before, this time what we don't know is in the smaller triangle. We don't know A. But still, just set up your equation as you normally would. We know that it would be this smaller left-hand side times by the scale factor to give you the larger left-hand side in the larger triangle. So therefore, I would get A times the scale factor 1.2 would give you 9. So just now in this situation, get A on its own. So if you have A times 1.2 equals 9, how will you get A on its own? Well, you divide both sides by 1.2, and that would give you, of course, A is equal to 7.5. And again, don't forget your units, so centimeters. So B is 9.6 centimeters and A is 7.5 centimeters. Okay, so this is our last question that we're going to do on similar triangles before we move on to a different type. So in this question, we are told that you have a 3.5 meter ladder leaning on a 2.4 meter fence, and one end is on the ground and the other end touches a vertical wall 2.9 meters from the ground. And we're asked, how far is the bottom of the ladder from the fence? So there's my ladder, there's my fence, and there is the height of my wall up to the ladder. 2.9, and this is obviously what we're looking for here, x meters. So what to watch out for a question like this, because this is a similar triangles question, okay? And I know the diagram at first glance doesn't look like the diagrams we've had previously, but what you want to do here is analyze. You have a smaller triangle here and a larger triangle here. And that's what's going to give you loads of information, because In that smaller triangle here, you have a right angle, and obviously that's that left-hand angle is the same in both that smaller triangle and that larger triangle. And of course, that's a 90 degree angle as well. So we know that that's a 90 degree angle and that's a 90 degree angle, and of course they share this angle here. So in that smaller triangle, it is similar to that larger triangle. In other words, the angles are the same. So like we've done before with the questions where the triangles are orientated differently, draw a sketch of these two triangles separately and you're going to see a lot clearer for yourself exactly what's going on here. And so this is what it would look like when we separate the two triangles and we put all the information in. So we know they are similar triangles, as I've said before, because this angle is common to both, and they both obviously have right angle triangles because it's a vertical wall, and the fence is obviously vertical as well. So it's 90 degrees to the ground. Analyze the information that we have on the corresponding lengths. Then we're talking about this height here corresponds with this height here. They're the two lengths that we have information or numbers on both. So that means then that 2.4 times something will give you 2.9. So to get what that something is, divide both sides by 2.4 and we get that K is equal to 29 over 24. Okay. Now, then analysing the fact that I want to find x, but I have a big problem here. I do not have any value for this corresponding base. And although I know what the scale factor is, if I don't know this base and I don't know the enlarged base, I don't have enough information right now. So let's have a little look over here, because they did give me this information 3.5, and they must have given that to me for some reason. So looking at this, and given the fact that I am dealing with a right angled triangle, and remember with any kind of geometry question, all your geometry facts can be at play. And anytime you see a right angled triangle, there should be something always popping into your head that could be at play here. And that is, of course, Pythagoras. We have a right angled triangle and we are in need of finding a side when given sides. Remember, Pythagoras is all about sides, looking for sides. So that's exactly what I'm going to do here. Using Pythagoras, I'm going to be able to find the length of this side here. So Pythagoras states that the hypotenuse squared is equal to the other two sides squared and added together. And remember, the hypotenuse, it's really important that you fill that one in first. It's the one that is always opposite the 90 degrees, your longest diagonal side. So it's always that one squared is equal to the other two sides squared and added together. So just for ease there, I'm going to label that one y, because it's going to be easier for me to put that in like that. So we'll call it y for the moment. So now I've got enough information to find out that y, in other words, the base of that larger triangle. So 3.5 squared is 12.25, and 2.9 squared is 8.41 plus y squared, and I'm going to take away the 8.41 from both sides to be left with y squared on its own. And then this on the left hand side works out to be 3.84, and now to go from y squared to y, I'll square root. And so the square root of 3.84 is 1.9596. I'm going to round it to four decimal places. The final answer asks for it to be rounded to one decimal place, but I'm not quite at the final answer yet, so I don't want to be rounding too early in my sum. So I'm going to give that plenty of decimal places before my final working out, and my final result will be rounded then to one decimal place. So now I know that that's equal to 1.9596. Now coming back to analyze our bases, this base multiplied by the scale factor, remember, will give this base. So x times the scale factor 29 over 24 must equal 1.9596. And so to get x on its own, I'm going to divide both sides by 29 over 24. That will get rid of that and leave me with x on its own. And this works out to be 1.6217. And now the question asks for it to be rounded to one decimal place. So rounding that to one decimal place, I get 1.6. Okay, so the next theorem we want to have a look at is this one that says that a line drawn parallel to one side of a triangle divides the other two sides in the same ratio. Okay, so jump straight into this triangle here, and we'll just take a look at what exactly this theorem is saying. So this is when you kind of have a triangle on top of a larger triangle, if you like. And given that you know this line is parallel to this line, that's what's said in the theorem, a line drawn parallel to one side of a triangle. Because you know that these lines are parallel, then of course what you have here is you have corresponding angles. You see the way you can make a backwards upside down F here, which would imply that that angle is equal to that angle. Obviously, they share the top angle if you consider this smaller triangle and this larger triangle. And again, you have corresponding angles here. In other words, a backwards F shape can be made here, in which case that angle has got to be equal to that angle. So we have, you see, similar triangles here. And so the ratios have got to be in proportion. So what this means then is this length divided by this length must equal this length divided by this length. That proportion has to be the same. You could also look at it like the whole length divided by the shorter length up here has got to equal the whole length on the other side divided by this shorter length up here, because again, the proportions have to be the same. Or we can consider it as the whole length divided by this bottom section must equal the whole length on the other side divided by the bottom section. Again, because the proportions have to be the same. Let's jump straight into an example here with numbers and length so we can see exactly what this theorem means in the context of a question. Okay, so let's take a look at this example here. So we can see that we have a line drawn parallel to one side of the triangle. So it's going to divide the sides in the same proportion. So what that means for us here, a number of things will be equal. So the proportions, if we take the side length 14 over its smaller side there, so that this length here divided by the smaller section, that has got to be equal to this section here divided by its smaller section. So that's one of the things that holds true, okay? Or I could look at it like this. I could say that 3 over the larger side 14, and just keep the very same order here, is equal to A over the larger side 12. The proportions and the ratios have to be the same. So obviously this one is going to be much easier to work with because I don't have the A underneath the line. That would always cause problems in the equation. So I'm going to go with this one, because any manipulation of that, once you have the ratios written up in the correct way and the correct, following the correct order, the corresponding sides, then go with the one that's going to be easiest for you to solve. So we're going to use this one here. And so we have 3 over 14 is equal to A over 12, and I want to get A on its own. So I'm going to multiply both sides by 12, and then that will get rid of the divide by 12 on that side. If I multiply that side by 12, as I said, I've got to multiply both sides by 12. So that side gets multiplied by 12. So 12 times 3 over 14 will equal the A. So that means then that A on its own is equal to 12 times 3 over 14, which is equal to 2 4/7. And that's my answer. Okay, so try this question. Pause the video here now and see how you get on with this. So we are looking for the lengths A and B. Okay, so I've done a sketch for myself here. And we can see that that is actually 7. So we have this line parallel to this side of the triangle, therefore the sides must be in proportion. So we're going to take a look at, I'm going to solve for A first. So I'm going to look at this smaller section and put it over this larger section. So A over 6, and I'm going to do the very same thing on the corresponding sides. This smaller section then must be equal to this smaller section over this corresponding section here. So A over 6 must be equal to 3 over 9. So now to get A on its own, I've got to get rid of the divide by 6. So I'm going to multiply that side by 6. That will get rid of that. And if I multiply the left-hand side by 6, I have to, of course, multiply the right-hand side by 6. So I am left with A is equal to 3 over 9 times 6, which works out to be 2. So A is equal to 2. Alright, so now that's equal to 2, put that in there, I'm now going to analyse the bases, and again, the bases must also be in the same proportion. So, I'm going to go with the two bits of information I have, because I have both bits of information here on the right hand side. I'm going to use those just in case I had made a mistake in the exam, for example, and I had just done something silly and made a mistake on that too. Your best always to continually go back to the information that is given to you in the question. You know for sure that has to be right. So I'm going to go back to this set of information here. Now, what I need to be careful of here is 7 is the base of the smaller triangle, and B is the base of the larger triangle. 9 is the side of the smaller triangle, that right-hand side of the smaller triangle, but 12 is the side of the larger triangle. Okay, in total it is 9 and 3, considering the larger triangle. So, the base of the larger triangle, which is B, over the base of the smaller triangle must equal the larger side, the side of the larger triangle, which is 12, over the smaller right-hand side of the smaller triangle, which is 9. So, do you see the way I'm putting that together? Be very careful that you are analysing the right things. So when we did the first bit, we could split it up into sections because we quite clearly had the two sections. But when we come to analysing the bases, it's the full base of the smaller triangle and the full base of the larger triangle. In which case, if we're using information on the right-hand side of the triangle, we've got to consider the full right-hand side of the smaller triangle and the total length, in other words, the full right-hand side of the larger triangle. So if I'm doing the larger base, so because I want my B on top rather than on the bottom of an equation, of a fraction in an equation, so the larger base over the smaller base will be equal to the larger right-hand side over the smaller right-hand side. Okay, so now, if I want to get rid of the divide by 7 to get B on its own, I'm going to multiply the left-hand side by 7. That will get rid of that. And if I do that on the left-hand side, I've got to multiply by 7 on the right-hand side. And so I'm left with B equals 12 over 9 times 7, which is 9 and 1/3. Okay, take a look at this question. So we are looking for the lengths X and Y in this particular diagram. Pause the video, see how you get on with this. Okay, so taking a look at this question then, we will analyse then this small section over the higher section on the left-hand side has got to be equal to this smaller section divided by its higher section on the right-hand side. So therefore, we have 4 over 12 must equal 6 over Y. So that's the way we would have looked at it in the previous couple of questions, but of course this time I don't want the Y on the bottom, so I'm going to analyse the larger part over the smaller part, which is also going to be a true ratio, and the larger part on the right hand side over the smaller part on the right hand side. So I can write like this, and this is going to be a much easier equation to work with. So I want to get y on its own on the right hand side. So to get rid of the divide by 6, I'm going to multiply the right hand by 6. That will get rid of that. If I do that on the right hand side, I have to do it on the left hand side. And so I'm left with y on its own, and then 6 times 12 over 4, which is 18. Okay, so y is 18. Now, we are looking for the base of the smaller triangle. So, like the previous question, we have to be careful here. We're talking about the full base of the smaller triangle, and we're going to look at that with relationship to the full base of the larger triangle. And so to get the proportion the same with the full lengths of the sides, I'm going to analyze these bases with regards to the left-hand side, where I have two numbers given to me on the left-hand side. So I'm going to look at the full length of the smaller left-hand side triangle, which is 12, and analyze it with the full length of the larger left-hand side of the triangle, which is going to be 12 add 4, which is 16 in total. So, the base of the smaller triangle over the base of the larger triangle, so the full base of the smaller over the full base of the larger, must equal the full length of the left-hand side of the smaller over the full length of the left-hand side of the larger triangle. And of course that is, as I said, 12 add 4, which is 16. So that's the ratio that's equal. And now I want to get x on its own. Since I've got to divide by 12, I'm going to multiply the left-hand side by 12. If I multiply by 12 on the left-hand side, I've got to multiply by 12 on the right-hand side. That gets rid of the divide by 12 and leaves me with x on its own. And then I have 12 over 16 times 12, which gives me 9. So x is equal to 9. And y is equal to 18. Okay, so the last question of this type we're going to look at, and what we're going to look for in this question are the missing lengths VW and WY. Okay, so those two missing lengths we'll look at, VW and WY. So find those two lengths for me. Press pause if you think you're confident enough to tackle this question now on your own. If not, take a listen and we'll go through it thoroughly. Okay, so here's a sketch of the question, and as I said, we're looking for these two missing lengths. I'm going to call this A and I'm going to call this B. Okay, so I'm going to look at A first. So I'm going to put this little section A over the larger section here, 10, because that ratio has got to be equal to this little section here, 4, over the larger section here, 8. Okay, and so we have divide by 10 on the left-hand side. To get rid of that, I'm going to multiply the left-hand side by 10, and if I do that, I've got to multiply the right-hand side by 10. So I'm left with A is equal to, and 4 over 8 times 10, which is, of course, 5. So A is equal to 5. Okay, so now I'm going to look at this left-hand side of the smaller triangle here, which I've labelled B, and it compares to the left-hand side of the larger triangle, which is 9. So, given these are full lengths, that's B is representing the full length of the left-hand side of the smaller triangle, and 9 is representing the full length of the left-hand side of the larger triangle, I've got to consider the full lengths now of the other side for comparing the ratios. So the two bits of information that's been given to me in the question that I know for sure have to be right are the 8 and 12. So 8 is the full length of the base of the smaller triangle, but it is 12, 8 add 4, which is the full length of the base of the larger triangle. So it's 8 and 12 the ratio that I need to analyze against the B and the 9. So what I have then is the left-hand side of the smaller triangle over the left-hand side of the larger triangle must equate to the base of the smaller triangle over the total base of the larger triangle, which is 12. And of course, now I want B on its own, so to get rid of the divide by 9, I'm going to multiply the left-hand side by 9. And if I multiply the left-hand side by 9, I've got to multiply the right-hand side by 9 as well. And that gives me B on its own equals 8 over 12 multiplied by 9, which gives me 6. Okay, so the last theorem we're going to take a look at is this one that says if you have three parallel lines and it cuts off equal segments on some transversal line, then they will cut off equal segments on any other transversal. Now, the word transversal just means a line crossing the parallel lines, okay? So let's say we have this transversal P, okay? You've got three parallel lines here, L, M, and N, and you know that the line P is cut into equal segments, okay, by the three parallel lines. Well, what the theorem is saying then, no matter what line, what other transversal line you draw across those three parallel lines, it will also cut that transversal in equal segments. So, for example, you draw this line over here and it's crossing the same parallel lines, then these two will be equal segments as well. If you know this transversal line has been cut into equal segments, then any other line that I draw that transverses, in other words, crosses those three parallel lines, then you know from this theorem that it will also cut it in equal segments. Okay, so this theorem is actually quite straightforward in the sense that once you know you've got your three parallel lines and, for example, it's cutting this transversal in equal sections, that's 12 and that's 12, then it's got to cut this transversal in equal segments, so that's 14, then that length there, x, has to be 14 as well. So taking a look at this question here, we are told that in this question, the parallel lines L, M, and N cut equal intercepts on the transversals P and Q. Find the values of X and Y. So we're told it does cut equal intercepts on both the transversals P and Q, which means then if that's 10, X is 10, and if that's 12, then Y is 12. Okay, so take a look at this question. And in this question, we are told that GH is 8 and JK is 7 centimetres. And we're asked to find the length of HI, so this length here, and GJ, so this length here. Okay, so I'll say that again. We're looking for the length HI and GJ. All right, pause the video and see how you get on with this. Okay, of course, if we know that P is being cut in equal intercepts, that means the transversal OR is also being cut in equal intercepts, which means that HI has to be 8 as well. And of course, it also means that this line Q has been cut in equal intercepts. So if that's 7, then GJ, which is what I'm looking for, has to also be 7.